return just for a few moments, please, this morning to Luke. You know, the reason for the birth of Jesus Christ is not just simply to celebrate hope in the middle of dark winter. It's not given for the sake of just get everybody to feel good about the baby and all that kind of thing. The purpose for Jesus being born in this world, God coming in the flesh among us, was to be our Lord and our Savior. A few moments ago, you saw Clark as he asked a question, what does Savior mean? It's wonderful to have God visit us. It's wonderful to have God amongst us. It's wonderful to have God's presence in this world. But the fact of the matter is, he came to be Savior. We look at a baby, a newborn baby in a mother's arms, and we get all oogly googly inside, and isn't that sweet and wonderful, and we're very, very grateful, of course, but the fact is he came to live for us a sinless life. He came to suffer in our place. And finally, he came to die in our place. He took upon himself our guilt, our shame, our sorrow, the unanswerable questions that we have from our hearts about what's beyond the veil of death. And he brought an answer to us that gives us hope and strength in our lives, a hope of an eternity with God in heaven. You say, Pastor, everybody wants peace after death. Well, it's only available through Christ. It's not available any other way. You know, some people would be happy if they would die like an animal dies, and that's it, turn to the dust and so forth. But we're the only ones made in God's image. We're the only ones that have an eternal life beyond the veil of this physical death. We're the only ones. And because of that special creation that God made us in his likeness, we have eternal life, whether we like it or not, whether we believe it or not, whether we even understand it or not, we're going to continue to live. And the word of the Lord says, those who receive God's plan will live for him forever in heaven, and with him there in peace and safety. And those who reject will have to be contained somewhere. And that's a life without God. And I cannot begin to imagine a life without contact, without relationship, without some kind of interaction going on. But the life beyond this life without God is without hope. And if you want to destroy someone's peace, you take away their hope. Even in studying war and the military and so forth, one of the things to do to prisoners of war is you take away all sense of hope from them. You have them go into solitary confinement. You have them with meager supplies and meager clothing and meager warmth or meager cooling or whatever it may be, or brilliant light all the time, and you dispossess them or take away from them any sense of hope of rescue or whatever. Ask some of our veterans who were prisoners of war. They saw hopelessness. And those who survived successfully somehow or other garnered some kind of hope, and it kept them alive. Friends, I want you to know this morning, God said, I don't want to leave you hopeless. I want to give you a great hope. Not an empty hope. Not a hope based on speculation, but a hope based on God's word itself. And so that's why the birth of Jesus. We celebrate it. We're joyous. The baby, he speaks of peace and strength and a hope for a new day and so on. But, oh, man, the hope for an eternity was so much more important. That God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever would believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. So God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, though we deserve condemnation, but he sent his Son that we might be saved through him. That's why the baby was born. That's why he lived. That's why he died that horrible death on the cross for us in our place. And when God raised him from the dead, God said, all right, now I have legal right before my own throat, before my own throne, because I've spoken those words that he who believes in the Lord Jesus Christ, I will receive and will not cast them out or cast them away. Friend, that's why hope speaks so powerfully to us. Well, hope is something that is deep within our hearts this morning as we return to Luke for just next maybe 15 minutes or so. Look carefully with me at verse number 35 of chapter 22, and it says this. And Jesus speaks to them, and he says, when I sent you without money bag, knapsack, sandals, did you lack anything? And they said, of course, nothing. Then he said to them, but now he who has money bag, let him take it, and likewise a knapsack, and he who has no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one. And I say to you that this which is written must be accomplished in me. And he was numbered with the transgressors. Jesus speaks from the Old Testament scripture, speaking of Christ's crucifixion between those two thieves upon those crosses, you'll recall. For the things concerning me have an end. And so they said, misunderstanding the Lord. So they said, yeah, look here, we have two swords. And he said to them, enough already. It says it's enough, but that's what it means. Okay, stop. You didn't catch it. We're going to go on from here, is what Jesus was really speaking to the disciples. A chapter or so before that, Jesus had sent them out to their own country area. And he said, when you go, don't prepare, but go and I'll provide for you. And that's exactly what the Lord did. But this time he is preparing them for something that will occur in Jerusalem when the nation falls in AD 70 and the Christians will be scattered all over the face of the earth. And he said, you be prepared. And God says to us in this day and the hour, don't get caught up short. Be prepared. Be prepared. Occupy till I come. Adversity happens in this world, friends. Be prepared. Don't be silly. Don't sit down on your duff and twiddle your thumbs. Get up, engage yourself, get after things, do something. Don't just sit and squander your life. The Lord's saying to his men, prepare, get ready, go. And when he says about buying a sword and so forth, some commentators feel that he talked about having a knife because they would need to protect themselves from wild animals as they went out in the boonies. Now, you know, wild animals, I have to protect myself from the donkeys when I drive down up 95. You know what I mean? Watch out for the donkeys. But I've never had to stop and wrestle with a cougar and stick him so he wouldn't get me. You know what I mean? But in those days, you walked or you rode your donkey and cougars were out there and other animals, bears and so forth. So he said, prepare yourself in such a manner. And they took it totally different. They said, yeah, I'm packing. Got a sword. Yeah, I'm okay. Because see, they were ready for war, not for life. And some people in this day and hour, we're ready for war. Come on. You want some of this? Let's step outside. Why? We're not supposed to be adversaries. We're supposed to do all that we can to maintain unity and the bond of peace, yeah? But be prepared. Be prepared. So what the Lord was saying to them, they didn't catch it. They didn't capture it. Go a little further with me, please. Hope prepares physically. He said, I want you to prepare physically, get ready. But in verse number 39, he's talking about hope preparing us spiritually. Watch this. So coming out, he went to the Mount of Olives as he was accustomed, and his disciples also followed him. And when he came to the place, he said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. Temptation is a word that we all deal with. My temptation is not your temptation. And I would suggest to you, if your temptation is to steal little green apples, then stay out of apple groves. Stay away from the apple section in the grocery store. Whatever your temptation is, avoid it. If alcohol isn't a temptation to you, avoid places that serve it. If something else tempts you, avoid such situations. Because see, temptation, nothing wrong with being tempted. It's wrong when you yield to the temptation. God's not going to condemn you just because you're tempted. Friends, we're human beings. Temptation happens all the time. But don't yield to the temptation, because that truly would then be sin. So he says, pray that you do not enter into temptation. And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. And the Lord was speaking so carefully to their hearts and their lives, saying simply this, listen carefully. He said, Lord, he said, this cup of iniquity, this cup of sin, this cup of crud and filth of the world, I'm going to be required to become a curse for these people. I know that's our plan, Father. I know that's what's going to happen. I know that I'm going to take all their sin upon me, become guilty with their sin. I know that I'm going to have to stand in the place and take all their iniquity upon me. I know that I'm going to have to bear it for the world. But if we can do it any other way, I'd be pleased if this cup would pass me, Father. But nevertheless, what your will is, not mine. And friend, I want you to know something. I cannot, for the life of me, I cannot put it in proper terms to you the ugliness of the hour when Jesus was brought finally to that cross and he bore our sins. If I were to give you an illustration, it would cause us to gag. Have you ever accidentally gotten the milk jug out of the fridge, as close as I can get without making this too ill, and you poured it in your coffee and you took a big slug of it and you go, ooh wee, the milk went bad? You ever had bad milk? It's nasty. I just tell you from personal experience. It's bad. It's really bad. Or you had something in the refrigerator. And we had some hot carrots once, and I popped the lid, and I was going to eat them, and all of a sudden it started frothing all by itself. And I go, oh, that's a clue. Yeah, hot carrots aren't supposed to boil in a cold jar. No, mm-mm. Thank God I didn't eat them. But friends, let me just say to you, Jesus was coming to that moment when the jar lid would be popped and he would take that putridness symbolically and consume it, becoming a curse for you and me. Upon that cross was not just Jesus hanging there with a loincloth around him. He was stark naked nude. His shame was to be seen by all in that position, in that posture, and yet he did it for us. Why? To bear it for you and me, that we would not have to bear it. To cause us to be able to come before the throne of grace when we should be condemned and have God say to us, I forgive you because of Christ Jesus, my Son. I cleanse you from all unrighteousness. I make you pure and clean and holy and undefiled because it is my will through my Son to deliver you and set you free from all that would normally await you. I have come to give you life, and that more abundantly. That was the task of Jesus Christ. And so he says this, oh, if it's your will, Father, let it pass from me, but nevertheless, your will, not mine. And then an angel, verse 43, appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. And aren't you glad that when you're feeling at your worst, God will send someone by to speak a word of grace into your life? I've had more pity parties, more down moments ruined by someone coming and declaring the word of the Lord and having it lift my heart, my soul, and my spirit. I've had more times when all was lost, it felt like, it seemed like, and here came God in the form of somebody to speak a word, to put a hand on my shoulder, to give me a hug, to speak a word of grace and lift my heart to my spirit. Friends, you oftentimes are someone's answer. And sometimes someone else that you least expect is your answer. Have an open ear. Have a teachable heart and spirit. If you ever take it upon yourself to no longer be teachable, then friends, even God himself cannot speak a word of grace to you because you wouldn't receive it. Have a teachable spirit. And everybody's, that's a good place to say amen, by the way. Being in agony, he was strengthened by the angels. But verse 44, being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. And I do understand from some scientists that extreme effort and turmoil in soul and mind can often cause the capillaries at the surface of the skin to leak off blood into the sweat glands, and it can be a sweat tinged with blood. Jesus was under great human stress at this time. Notice in verse 45, when he rose up from prayer, had come to his disciples, he found them sleeping from sorrow. They were so full of grief and agony over what was occurring that it just absolutely fatigued them. Have you ever been in such a place? Fatigued beyond what you were capable of bearing, and you just wanted to sleep. Just, I want to forget my problems. Just let me sleep. I want to forget the pressure. Just let me sleep. I want to hide in this or that or the other. Just let me withdraw. Friends, we don't often have the chance to withdraw. Sometimes we just got to grit our teeth and stand up and stand there and go, God, I'm going to depend on you because I just want to sit down and quit. Well, bless God, don't quit. Just get up and go in the name of the Lord. There are times to be quiet and alone. I understand. There are times to reflect. But don't quit. Don't give up. Please, I beg you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, don't give up because he'll send his angels to strengthen you. He'll arise, cause your faith to arise in your heart once again and cause you to triumph in Christ Jesus. He came not to bring us defeat, but victory in the Lord Jesus Christ. God's looking for a way to lift us up, give us witty ideas and concepts, cause his strength to be perfected in the midst of our weakness. When you are weak, Paul even writes this, he says, then I am strong, for I found that his strength is perfected in my weakness. When I feel the weakest, I go, oh boy, here comes strength. Watch out. I don't feel like it, but I know it's coming. I don't even know where it's coming from, but I know it's coming from God in some form. I feel weak. I sense weakness, but strength is about to bust up inside me and come forth mightily. Glory to God. Let it be the trigger in your heart. When you feel the lousiest, he's the strongest. When you feel in the darkest place, he is the brightest. When you feel like you cannot, he rises and says, you can through Christ who strengthens you. Friend, arise in your most holy faith, and God will not fail you. Look a little further, please. He says to them, why do you sleep? Rise and pray unless you enter into temptation. Friends, oftentimes our reaction comes before our prayer. Our reaction to something comes before our prayer. Friends, pray up. Pray up. Store up your prayers. Intercede. Even when you feel the greatest, pray, God, just help me. Strengthen me through these things, whatever's coming. When you feel an urgency to prayer, pray. Let me just tell you, God's looking down the ways just a little bit, and he goes, oh, boy, it's going to hit him right there. It's coming. Coming closer. Coming closer. He goes, pray. 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 Pray, hey, pray. And you're going, why? I feel pretty good. Everything is going pretty well. The Lord's saying, pray, pray. Okay, I'll take some time. I pray, intercede. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Lord, bless me and strengthen me for this day. God, help me. And all of a sudden, thwonk, and you go, good thing I prayed. Because God strengthens you. You know what? Prayer just causes you to be armed with the armor of the Lord. It enables you to stand, and having done all, stand faithfully. Will the winds blow? You betcha. Will the earth rumble around you? You betcha. Will things turn squirrely? You betcha. But he brings us from victory unto victory, from glory unto glory, with the full assurance that he who has called you and started a good thing in you will complete it in Christ Jesus. Don't give up. Press on. But pray in the process. Oh, I could just almost preach this morning. In verse number 47, watch with me, and it says this. Now hope also prepares in spite of setbacks. Listen to this carefully. Hope also prepares in spite of setbacks. Verse 47, and while he was still speaking, behold, a multitude, and he who was called Judas, one of the 12, went before them and drew near to Jesus to kiss him. And by the way, in Eastern cultures, many places around the world, it's customary to greet one another with a kiss on either side of the cheek or whatever. And that's custom. It's normal and all the kind of stuff. And here he comes. He who was a friend has now turned against Jesus Christ. But notice the patience of Jesus Christ. Watch this, please. But Jesus said to him, Judas, and one of the Gospels says, he calls him friend. Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss? Even in that last moment, Jesus was giving Judas a chance. Why don't you repent? Why don't you turn from your wickedness, even at this moment? And Judas wouldn't hear that. Listen, friends, if you're so bullheaded as to run on in your own rebellion, God will let you hit the brick wall. Did you hear that? If you're bullheaded enough, God will allow you to hit the brick wall, because he's not going to force you. He'll throw obstacles in your way to stop you, but he's not going to force you to change your heart and your mind and your spirit. That has to be your choice. He's given you that ability. Look a little further, and it says, but in verse 49, and when those around him saw what was going to happen, they said to him, they were still misunderstanding what he said just a few paragraphs before, Lord, shall we strike with a sword? And I'm sure those guys just reached for their swords real quick. And Peter was first to draw it. Maybe, I don't know who the other guy had the sword, but Peter, little short, squat, bald-headed guy, bow-legged, he was close to the ground, short in the wheelbase and ready to go. Boom! He brings that sword out, and he swings at the guy's neck, but he misses and cuts off his ear. Watch what happens. And he said, shall we strike with a sword? Verse 50, and one of the other Gospels identifies this as Peter, struck the servant of the high priest, that's Malchus, we know his name from another report, and cut off his right ear. But Jesus answered and said, permit me this. And here the guards holding Jesus back. Peter gets all excited. He gets loose. He comes, whack, gets the guy's ear. It falls to the ground. And Jesus says, let me go, guys. Got to take care of something. And he comes over and he picks up the ear. Now, I know some of you are saying, he picked up the ear? It doesn't say that. Well, it says he healed it. So whether he picked up the ear and put it back on or caused a new one to grow, I don't care. He healed the guy's ear. Now, however you want to believe it, I don't care. All I know is the guy's full of blood. His ear had a problem. It was either gone or sliced in half or whatever the deal was. Jesus either picked it up, put it back on, or caused it to grow again. I don't care. But the guy's ear was healed. Can you imagine Malchus going back to the high priest's house? He's a servant of the high priest. He goes, what happened to you, buddy? You're all bloody. What's the deal? Well, one of the guys got excited. He aimed for my neck and got my ear. And Jesus, who we went out to arrest, he healed my ear. I got to change clothes and wash these clothes. Can you imagine what happened to that young man's faith? It doesn't tell us, but I would warrant that Malchus had a come to Jesus meeting at that moment and realized there was some power available. And you know, the person, listen, full of doubt, full of despair, even against Jesus, if a person is honest and true with themselves, Holy Spirit will whisper to their hearts, this is truth, walk in it. This is truth. And friends, you see, Jesus doesn't come as an adversary against people. He comes as a confederate, one who comes, a confidant, one who comes to assist and to help and to make whole. That's how Jesus approaches even the most recalcitrant heart. The person that is set dead against even believing in God, God woos and draws with grace that heart and that life. Not with a stick over the head, but with a wooing of the heart. Would you listen to truth? Would you respond to the truth of a real, live God? Jesus heals the guy. Verse 52, then Jesus says to the chief priests, captains of the temple, and elders who had come to him, have you come out even as against a robber with swords and clubs? Well, when I was with you daily in the temple, you did not try to seize me, but this is your hour and the power of darkness. Listen, friends, for the first time in all of creation, God himself in the flesh, on the earth, submits to the activity of the evil one. You see, the word declares in another place that had the principalities and powers of the air, the demonic forces known, that Jesus was going through death to defeat the authority and power of death, they would not have allowed the Son of God even to die. They would have guarded him. But see, God's plan was to thwart the enemy with a secret move that was absolutely unimaginable in any human heart or in any demonic realm, that God himself would take upon himself our guilt and shame and thus fulfill the law to the point that God the Father would be able to forgive every heart and life who believed in that kind of love and that kind of freedom. Oh my God. Oh my God. When we could not qualify, God qualified us. When we could not be in the place to impress God in any way, shape, or form, he, without emotion, without feeling one way or the other, just because it was right, made a way for us to be redeemed, brought back to him without sin or shame in our lives. He paid the debt that we owed, and he gave himself that we might return to him. Look a little further, please, with me in the scripture. Hope prepares a forgiveness. Watch this. Jesus had been the last 4 days in the temple, and no one laid a hand on him. They were upset. They were torqued. They were absolutely desirous of his death. They planned it. Judas contacted them. They saw a way. And in the midst of the night, in a quiet moment, without the crowds around, they took Jesus away, and Jesus submitted to it. Verse 54, having arrested him, they led him and brought him into the high priest's house. But Peter followed at a distance. And now when they had kindled a fire in the midst of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. And a certain servant girl, how come is it that young ladies, they're observant, aren't they? And she has seen him elsewhere. And she responds, seeing him as he sat by the fire, looked intently at him and said, this man was also with him. But he denied him. He denied him, saying, woman, I don't know him. Verse 58, and after a little while, another person saw him and said, yeah, you're one of them. And Peter said, man, I am not. One of the other gospels says, he swore, I've never seen the man. He used some spiteful words. I never know him. I don't know him. I don't know anything about him. And after a little while, another saw him and said, you're also one of them. Peter said, man, I am not. And then after about an hour had passed, another confidently affirmed, yeah, surely this fellow who was with him, he is a Galilean. But Peter said, man, I don't know what you're saying. And at that very moment, while he was still speaking, the rooster crowed. Remember, Jesus had said, you're going to deny me before the rooster crows 3 times. Recently, I was in Phoenix, an American Indian college, and there took my master's course. And about 5:30 every morning, I stayed in the dorm, about 5:30 every morning, someone in the neighborhood, North Phoenix there, has a rooster. I was ready to fry a rooster, let me tell you. Fried chicken sounded real good at 5:30 in the morning. He didn't do it once, he did it many times. So, you know, I got up and I studied and I made good use of the time. But the fact is, roosters will rouse you up. Watch carefully, please. Immediately, while he was speaking, rooster crowed, and the Lord turned and looked at Peter. He was within sight. I can see. Have you ever done something squirrely, done something wrong, and you looked, and your mom or your dad goes, yeah. And they knew that they knew, and you knew that they knew. And he looks at Jesus, and Jesus looks not with a condemning eye, but with an eye that said, I'm walking in forgiveness, Peter. I'm walking in forgiveness. Hope prepares forgiveness. And that's exactly what Jesus was looking at Peter with, an eye of forgiveness. Watch this, please. Before the rooster crows, he had told him before, you'll deny me 3 times. And Peter went out and he wept bitterly. Have you ever wept bitterly because of your failure? Because of your choice to do wrong? And then instead of finding condemnation, you found the grace of God to help in the time of need. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, God, for your mercy and your grace. Almost done. Verse 63, hope prepares a strong heart to stand. Listen carefully. And now the men who held Jesus mocked him, beat him, having blindfolded him, they struck him on the face and asked him, saying, prophesy, who is the one that struck you? And many other things they blasphemously spoke against him. Abused, ridiculed, harmed, hurt, put down, offended deeply. But Jesus didn't answer a word. Jesus, in verse number 66, friends, because he had a strong heart to stand, he was prepared. The hope of obeying his Father launched in him the ability to stand, and having done all to stand. Now, hope prepares the truth. In verse 66, as soon as it was day, the elders of the people, both chief priests and scribes, came together and led him into their council, in the council of Sanhedrin, the 70 rulers of Israel. If you are the Christ, tell us. I can hear them say it to him. If you're the Christ, tell us. And he said to them, if I tell you, you will by no means believe. Listen, if God himself spoke to some people in this world, they would not believe. Why? Because their hearts are set in unbelief. You cannot convince a person against their will. God will not try that. Because a person convinced is a person who will stand. My heart goes out to atheists in this world. With all their hearts, they believe there is no God. They clench their teeth, and they, with all their being, they use every excuse that they possibly can not to believe in a God. Why? Because if there is a God, they'll have to answer to him. They can no longer be the liberal individual that they would like to be. But God calls even to the heart of the atheist and says, love, love, not condemnation, love. Love, mercy, peace. I'm willing to give all of that to you and more if you'll only believe. And the person strongly willed against God will one day face the God they did not believe in. And then God will have to deal with them accordingly because of their unbelief. But watch this, please. And they said, if you are the Christ, tell us. And he said to them, if I tell you, you will by no means believe. Why? Because they were already predisposed not to believe. And if I also ask you, and you will by no means answer me or let me go. And hereafter, he said in verse 69, the Son of Man will sit on the right hand of the power of God. And they all said, I can see them get up off their stools, their chairs, and they're screaming, are you then the Son of God? Bring it to conclusion. Are you then the Son of God? And he said to them, you rightly say that I am. He said, yeah, you're right. I am. They got angry all the more, and they said, what further testimony do we need? For we have heard it ourselves from his own mouth. Here's the thing, precious friend. Jesus himself was in that room, spoke to those elders, spoke to that Sanhedrin, and declared who he was. And they screamed back at him. But by the way, just a little note from Acts. Many of the priests and the Levites came to a saving knowledge after the resurrection. And I'll guarantee you some in that very room finally came to faith in Christ Jesus. Oh, my friend, God has a special plan for each of us. When he says to you, who do you say that I am? What's your answer? What will be your answer? Banners of Love have a ministry to present to us, and I'll conclude following their presentation this morning.
I, Jesus, have sent my messenger, my angel, to you to witness and to give you assurance of these things for the churches. I am the root, the source, and the offspring of David, the radiant and brilliant morning star. The Holy Spirit and the bride, the church, the true Christians say, come. And let him who is listening say, come. And let everyone come who is thirsty, who is painfully conscious of his need of those things by which the soul is refreshed, supported, and strengthened. And whoever earnestly desires to do it, let him come, take, appropriate, and drink the water of life without cost.
by grace that we are saved. Through faith and not by works. For it is through Jesus we have life. A blessing to live is Christ. Come, let us adore Him. Come, let us.
Door.
I wonder, do you know him? I wonder, do you know him? Jesus stepped into this world, the eternal Word of God, became, took upon himself flesh that day. We celebrate his birth. Marvelous, wonderful, great thing. But then do we think of the importance of his life, the importance of his death, the importance of what he did for us? Friend, as I said in the message a few moments ago, I cannot describe to you the level of filthiness that had to be heaped upon Jesus Christ in order for him to suffer and pay the cost for you and for me on that cross. But when the Father raised him from the dead on that third day, he was totally, completely, absolutely free. The reason I say that is because as years went by, John the Revelator writes in Revelations, he says, on the day the Lord opened the heavens to me and opened the future, he said, I looked and I beheld the throne of grace, and I looked to see God, and all I saw was the emanation of great, beautiful colors that came forth. He said, it's something I cannot physically, humanly describe. And he said, suddenly, I saw the hand of God hold the scroll of the answer to man's existence, the end of the story, in other words. And he said it was sealed with seven seals, and no one in heaven nor earth nor under the earth in any place, no one was found worthy to approach the throne of grace. And he said, I was devastated. So I fell to my face weeping on the ground. There is no answer. There is no answer. There is no answer. He cried. He was destitute. And he said, suddenly someone nearby touched him on the shoulder and said, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, he has been found worthy to take the scroll and break the seals. And he said, I looked up and I was expecting to find a raging lion of the tribe of Judah somewhere. Instead, all I saw was a lamb as though he were slain from before the foundation of the world, and that was Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. And he said, all of a sudden, he walked across the sea of glass where no one else dared to tread. He approached the throne of God. He said, he reached out, he took the scroll, the end of the story. And he said, he stood there, and the angels got so excited, they began to sing a loud song of praise and worship. The 24 elders seated on the thrones around the throne of God, they got happy and jumped up and took their crowns and cast them at the feet of the Lord. And they began to sing and shout, oh, you were found worthy. You were found worthy. You who were found worthy, you have taken the scroll. And now the answers will come forth. Jesus, the righteous, began to break those seals. My friends, he who is worthy is the one who stands before you in heaven today, pleading and interceding. This may be your day to surrender your life to the Lord. I cannot see across the congregation this morning, but if you're here, you know in your heart it's you. And I don't care what someone's told you or what stories you've believed or how you've been taught or the position that you've taken. You may not even believe in God, but yet something strikes at you this morning and says, there's truth and there's hope. God has hope for me. Friend, I just would ask all of us to repeat this prayer this morning, please, everyone in the house. And if you're here and you mean this from your heart, the Lord said he would save you. He would prepare you to be in his presence forever and ever. He would bring hope to your heart, banish forever your hopelessness. That's what Jesus is all about. So, congregation, if you'd pray this prayer aloud with me, just repeat it after me. Dear Heavenly Father, come before you just as I am. And I ask you, Lord, to forgive me of my sin. I do believe you love me so much that you came. that you lived sinlessly and you died full of my sin and you forgave me through the cross. I thank you now that you live forever. And I believe, Lord, as I ask for forgiveness, you forgive me completely. Make me your own child. In Jesus' name. Amen, amen. We believe as you pray that prayer of faith from a heart that truly believes what God has said, he saves you. And from the inside out, he begins to do a work of grace that you can't do by turning a new leaf or trying to make a decision one way or the other, or trying to do things differently or best intentions. When you pray that prayer of faith, you allow God to begin to work on the inside of you. Watch for the changes as he begins to bring your life into a new place. Would you stand with me this morning, please? Hallelujah. So glad to have had you with us. God bless you. For the blessing this morning, the pastoral blessing, please. The offering, yes. Ushers, take your place at the back door, please. And they'll receive your offering as you go out this morning. You can put it in the bag or on the box on the wall, however you'd like to do. For the blessing this morning, church, may the Lord bless you. May he keep you. May his face shine upon you, be gracious unto you, and may he give you peace. And may the Spirit of the Lord cause you to just rise up in your most holy faith and believe and expect great things of God, and even to know that in your weakness, God's strength is perfected in you. And God, who started a good thing in you, will complete it in Christ Jesus. So, my friend, in this season, go in the peace of God and in his grace, in Jesus' precious name. Touch someone for the Lord. Amen.